Jesus the Christ bless each and every one of you. I thank you for tuning in to today's discussion, and I do emphasize the word discussion. When I am doing a teaching, most often you'll know that it's a teaching, and I'll say that, you know, I'd like to do this teaching, or I'm going to be teaching today on this subject. But today it's just a discussion, and I don't say just a discussion, but it is a discussion. I think discussions are just as important as teaching, and also I think it goes along with my topic today. I don't know what I'm going to entitle this, but by the end of this I will. But I think discussions show that we as Christians, we do more than just, you know, we can have a scriptural conversation. Let me put it this way. We can have a scriptural and godly conversation without me having to always bring 10 scriptures, 10 prayers, and a song. You understand what I'm saying? But any discussion around the Word of God or something that is supposed to be seen from a biblical perspective should at least include the Word. Even if it's not read word for word, you should refer back to the Word. So I think the discussions are mainly beneficial to those who are students of the Word, who meditate on it, who study. And even it's also beneficial to those who are new in Christ, or those who have questions and may have not known a certain point of view that's shared in the Bible, or may have known that certain scriptures exist concerning that topic that they may have been meditating on. Okay, so I hope I made that clear. So I think the discussions are just as important as teachings, okay? And also, don't put me in a box. And I say that, you know, in the most peaceful way, with all peaceful intentions. And I think that goes along the lines with this today's discussion of us being humans and being able to serve Christ and still, you know, maintain our humanity, not our fleshliness, but our humanity, you know. And I want to thank Linda McGinnis. I'm subscribed to her. She did a vlog today, and it really encouraged me to go ahead and upload and share this. Now, this is something that I've already been meditating on, already been studying for a couple of weeks, and already been thinking about. But her vlog, if you want to check it out, video that she uploaded today, let me see if I can find it. But in it, she was discussing emotional healing from Facebook. I think that's the name of it, emotional healing from Facebook and relationships, right? And her channel is Linda McGinnis, and that's McGinnis. And, you know, it's sometimes as Christians, we think that, and teachers of the Word, we can't, some people try to keep you in a box to where, okay, you only preach to us, or you only teach to us, right? And then you have the other group who don't want to listen to you because you only preach or you only teach. So you have one group who always wants to pull you towards fleshly, carnal conversations, and then you have the other group who only want to keep you in a box of, if you're not saying thus and thou, then you're not teaching and preaching. Okay, so those who have been aboard this channel for a while, you know that you know, sometimes I come on and I do videos like something is wrong with that, you know, because I just want to talk about things that are, something is wrong with it. Now, I may not be able to find a scripture said, thus saith the Lord, something is wrong with that. But at the same time, we can sit from a Christian perspective, a godly perspective, and filter things in the society and see that something is wrong with that, you know, whatever that is at that time that you're expressing, or I was expressing. But today I just want to just say that as Christians, yes, we can learn from our emotions. We can learn from our humanity, you know? And if you Southern like me, you say we can learn from our humanness. In the South, humanness is a word, you know? And you may say, yeah, it really is a word. But, you know, in the South, we know when you say that, we mean humanity, okay? Our human nature, our just being humans, right? And I thank Linda for uploading that. You know, she discussed emotional healing. She discussed, you know, how sometimes we know what to do, but in relationships we may respond wrong, you know. And I wanted to discuss how sometimes we have wrong thoughts towards God. You know, we often limit it to others, but oftentimes we can have wrong thoughts towards God, or we can be angry with God. And if you have been listening to this channel or bored this channel for some time, you know that I shared one time that I was mad with God, angry with God for, at one time in my life, I think I was angry for about a year, you know, or at least that's when I realized it. He told me, he showed me that I was angry, you know, because of disappointment of something that I knew and had been believing God for, and he didn't do it. Or, yeah, he didn't do it. Or he didn't do it in my timing. Or he didn't do it in my way. Or he didn't do it at all. There were several things. And, you know, it's hard to believe God for something. It's easy to believe God for something you know He can do, even the most impossible things for humans to do, and you know God can do it. For example, healing, for example, to save the life of a loved one who's dying, and you know that He can do it. You know what His promises are. You know within yourself, or you feel within yourself, that this is not the timeliness. Say, for example, in death of someone's death. Or it's just against the promises and the word of God. And when he doesn't do it because he is sovereign, we can become angry with God. Or sometimes, you know, for example, let's look at Matthew 24, 25. Give me a minute. 25, Matthew 25. And in Matthew 25, it's the story of the parable of the talents. There's a in this parable, Jesus tells us of he compares the kingdom of God to a man traveling into a far country, and before he goes into that far country, he gives money to his servants. And it says talents, but basically he gives them money to trade and to increase, right? And he gave one 5 talents, he gave another 2 talents, and he gave another 1 talent. And so his only expectation was that by the time he returns, that they would have increased, you know, returned to him what was his plus increase it, right? And so the one with 5 talents went and traded, the Bible it says no, and he gained 5 more. And then the one with 2 talents, he took it and he traded it and he gained 2 more. And so at the end of the day, the one with 5 ended with 10, the one with 2 ended up with 4. But the one who had the 1 talent, we learned a lot about what his thoughts were towards God, you know, just by his word. The one with the 1 talent, in verse 24, it says, then he which had received the 1 talent came and said, this is after the master returned, said, Lord, I knew you. He starts off by saying, I know you. I know that you are a hard man. Let's just stop right there. This is what the servant thought about the master all the time. He said, I knew that you, I know you. And I, not only do I know you, I know that you are a hard man. You are a hard man. That's what I know about you. So a lot of times you never know what a person thinks about you until a time of testing. You know, a time of testing. Then during that time of testing, when that person feels pressured, then they come out and they say what they really think about you. Okay? And this is an example of that. This man was in a time of testing. You know, he had to put his talents to work. Okay? And because he was feeling pressured, his words began to relay what he really feels, or he begins to express what he really feels about his master. And he says, I knew you, that you are a hard man. And this is, not only are you a hard man, you reap where you have not sown. Okay, so let's stop right there. This servant not only thinks that his master is hard, but he feels that his master increases at the expense of others. He feels that his master is gaining something, and he's not doing any labor for it. Other people are laboring, but the master is increasing. And haven't you, especially if you have ever owned a business and you've ever had people working for you, those of you who have, you run into this a lot. Or even if you don't have people working for you, say you've been a contractor and you, for example, you get a job where you are flipping a house, let's say that, okay? And say you deal with contractors on a regular basis, and you have painters that you deal with on a regular basis, you have carpenters that you deal with on a regular basis, you have plumbing guys that you deal with on a regular basis, all right? So, you know, you build sort of a friendship with these guys, right? So those of you who have ever owned a business, those of you who have ever done any business with contractors, and you have some sort of friendship or long-term relationship with them, after some time, you've heard the phrase that familiarity breeds contempt. Well, you know, there's a little bit of truth to that, okay? And I'm saying all of this because as humans, even as Christians, we have to watch our thoughts. We have to watch our mental attitudes, you know, because we can have the same mental attitude that a lot of people in the world have, okay? So let me get back to this guy. He was saying that, I know that you are, first of all, you're a hard man. Second of all, you reap where you haven't sown. And I brought in the contractor examples because a lot of times when you work with people, if you're flipping a house and you work with them, they know that they're going to be paid for their job. But they know at the end of the day, when all the work is finished, you're going to earn a certain amount of money, right? And they feel that they are doing all the labor and all the work, and you're the one that's reaping the thousands of dollars in benefits. Now, did they not agree to do their job for that price? So what concern is it of them that you are making thousands of dollars above that? Can they not go out and do the same thing? And this is the same attitude that this servant has. He felt that the Lord was going to reap of his hard work and of his hard labor, and he didn't think that that was right. And so he says, you're reaping, you reap where you have not sown, and you gathered where you have not strawed. We have three things. One, I know you, familiarity. Two, you're hard. Three, you reap what is not yours. You benefit from other people's hard labor. And then he goes on and then he reveals who his personal problem is. His personal problem was, and I was afraid. See, do not allow other people's fears to keep you in bondage. That's my fourth point. Okay, we're talking about attitudes, negative attitudes towards God, negative attitudes towards others. It can really, if you allow it, it can keep you in a box, you know. So when I come on and I express things that I feel the Lord has me to share, I'm going to share it. I'm not going to allow other people's bondages to keep me in bondage. And that's what happens as teachers of the word, as ministers of the gospels, as everyday Christians and followers of Christ. You cannot allow other people's bondages to encapsulate you, and therefore you find yourself in bondage, right? He says, and I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the earth. So see, there you have, that is yours. So he thought, you know, okay, I'm afraid because I know you're hard. And if I take this out here and I don't reap what you think I should reap and earn, then, you know, you're a hard man and I'm going to have to deal with your harshness. So, you know, I went and hid your money. Here it is. You have what's yours. Now, that would have been fine if that was the only reason. It wouldn't have been fine, but I really believe that this man's real problem with the good master was that the master was going to increase. And so you find a lot of times that people have problems with your increase, other people's attitudes, their fears for going out to do, for not going out and doing the same thing that you're doing keeps them in bondage. But because you are going out and doing something and they are afraid that they won't succeed at it, then they don't want to help you increase. And I find that a lot. You know, when I first started out in missions, I never asked people for anything. I think I did that twice, and I learned not to do that ever again. And I've had that nonprofit for many years. And I tell you, any money that I got, I can count over more than 15 years, I can count and tell you the money that I've received and help from any source from total sources has been less than $1,000. $1,000 wouldn't even buy one airline ticket, not even one way. Okay, so, and I don't say that boastfully. So that means that the other monies that I've used and gotten has been money that the Lord has given me and has provided to me directly. Okay. And I don't like to ask because sometimes people feel that if you ask, you're going to be running around the world living your dreams on their money. Okay? And we have a very bad problem with that. I can speak of my own community. Let me be myself. Okay? That's what this video is about. Being able to express yourself and share your thoughts within Christ. Right? Show our humanity without being in the flesh. There is a difference. And so particularly in our community, and I say community, I'm speaking about certain ethnic communities, not just African-American communities, but even in certain classes, there's that crab in the bucket mentality, you know, where I'm not going anywhere, but I don't want you to go anywhere either. You know, so crabs, I grew up in the South near the ocean. So, you know, if you put crabs in a bucket, you don't even have to put a lid on them, honey. You just put them in the bucket. They're not going anywhere. They'll keep pulling each other down. Okay. And so even in doing the Lord's work, sometimes you run into that lack of support because someone may feel that you are going somewhere that they are afraid to try to go. Okay. Or perhaps the Lord hasn't called them there. Okay, sometimes people are not content with where they are or where the Lord has called them. And sometimes their attitude towards God is negative. Say, for example, that God has given them a gift and a talent. And sometimes you find that a lot with people who are not born again. They can sing and they don't want to come to Christ. They don't want to give their life to Christ because they believe that the day I give my life to Christ, he's going to require this gift. He's going to require that I never use this gift again. Or if I do, I'm only going to have to sing it in the church, you know, and I'm only going to be able to sing in the church. Okay. I think if you're born again, you have a new song. I do believe that God will give you a new song, right? But it doesn't believe that the song that God gives you cannot reach the world without being worldly. See, we have in the church where a lot of times where people come into Christ, they have that gift and talent, but instead of using it to reach the world for Christ, they want to be in the church, but then they still want to be worldly. There's a difference in reaching the world and being worldly. So a lot of times people will just stay out until their gifts. You see that a lot of times with people who are R&B singers. They sing for the devil for years. They sing for the world for years. And then now when they're old, they want to come into the church and then they want to start singing gospel. And they want all of us to come and listen to them. When they've used their gift up in the world, they were afraid to give it to God because they thought that he was going to require that they give up something. Right? Or that he was going to benefit from it, but they weren't going to benefit from it. Like this person who'd received the talent, the servant. He felt like the master was going to increase by it, but he wasn't going to increase, so why should he do all the labor? So this, I don't know how long I've been speaking, but I just wanted to have just a brief discussion on our humanity and on our thoughts as Christians. And it may not have been 10 scriptures in a poem, but I believe that it's reached you in some way or another. And those of you who are believing God for things, and you get disappointed, you get weary sometimes, and your mind just wants to, you know, you get, and you know, just filled with negativity and anger even towards God. Take that anger even to him, you know. Bring him in remembrance of his word. I won't promise you that he will do it, but you know what? If you leave this earth, reminding him of his promises, then you just leave his this earth reminding him of his promises. When you see him, you can just, that'll be the first thing you all discuss, other than saying, thank you, Lord, for saving me. Thank you. You know what? In eternity, it won't matter. But just in case you want to discuss it at that time, I'm sure he'll be happy to give you an answer. So I thank you for tuning in. I thank you for listening to me express myself, express through the Spirit of Christ, and just discuss. The discussion itself is about the humanity of the followers of Christ. All right? So God bless you. Have a wonderful day.